There can never be a question whenever a man of renown, a man who has stood up to be the best version of himself, a great man, a man of glory, there can never be a question when that man speaks. That's why they get quoted. And by the way, talking about getting quoted, I've always wanted to be quoted and nobody has been quoting me. So I decided to be quoting myself. But what I'm discussing in this episode is about personal glory. That I do believe at the basic level, every human being, male or female, they have their personal glory to which they're supposed to ascend. The potential to have that personal glory is already there. But what matters is how they get to that level of personal glory. And you can never, ever go wrong with someone who has come of age, the fullness, the greatness, their majesty. When they show up, you know the world is blessed by that. So we're discussing in this episode about the man, the males. How do we ascend to the level of our personal glory? Stay tuned.
Welcome to the Life Signatures Podcast with Lawrence Namale. Lawrence is a life coach, author, and keynote speaker who loves to tackle different topics on purpose, productivity, and resilience. His mission in life is to awaken all your boundless possibilities available in you. Life Signatures Podcast is dedicated to bring to reality every single person who knows that deep down in their gut, there's got to be more to life than this. And now, here is your host, Lawrence Namale.
The simplest description of personal glory is the state, the fullness of the state of the existence of something that was created. Look at the sun, for example. It is in its personal glory. It's interesting that many things that are not living have this awesomeness with them. Look at the mountains. Look at the snowy mountains. Look at the plants. Look at, okay, let's just go into the environment and look at the fish, the whale, when you put it in the right environment. Look at the animals in the wild when you put them in the right environment. Even the ones that are being chased away by lions and so on, being eaten up. Look at the gazelle in its stateliness. It is, look at the peacock. It is in its fullness, the fullness of its personal glory. The only problem we have is the human species who are never in the fullness of their personal glory at some point in time or another. And that's why I'm discussing in these episodes, why do we need to have our personal glory? So your personal glory is the highest form of your greatness that you are capable of and that you are intended to have in the first place. There is potential for it. There is seeds for it, there's seeds for greatness in every human being. Nobody is exempt. The greatest people are not just the Kens Arowiwas of Nigeria and the Kwame Nkrumahs of Ghana and the Jomo Kenyattas of Kenya and the Tom Boyers of Kenya and the Martin Luther King Juniors of the USA, the T.D. Jakeses of this world and the Elon Musks of this world and the Steve Jobses of this world. Everyone in their own unique way. That's why personal glory is never going to be equal. And the problem we have today is that we are teaching people the same things. That's why we need to go back to the definition of education. Education is coming from the Latin word, I believe, called educare, which means to pull out, to draw something out. The problem is that we are trying to fill people in with things, the same things, like we're mass producing people. And that's why it's a bit difficult, a bit cumbersome to have everyone come to the fullness of their personal glory and to the fullness of their majesty. Why? Because the filling in of things with people eliminates others in, you know, incremental ways. In primary school, you are eliminated if you don't qualify to go to high school. In high school, you are eliminated if you don't qualify to go to university or to go to college. And what does that do to people? It sends people negative signals that they are no longer needed. They don't matter anymore. And people never live up to the fullness of their extent, the fullness of their personal glory, their stateliness, their majesty, their grandeur. And man, let's talk about ourselves. There is this thing about the desire of a man of greatness, a man of renown. I'm talking about the male man. In this day and in this age, you've got to make that distinction. There are two genders, okay, that we know of. Of course, we're trying to implement others, or trying to manufacture others, you know, non-binary and cross this, cross that, and so on. Biologically, there are two genders. There is the male and then there is the female. And I'm addressing the male gender today because there are some things in society that are connected to gender, by the way. Some of the problems we're having in society are gender-based problems. In fact, they are going to be as a result of us not having an identity in gender. And a man needs to live to the greatness of his capacity, of his possibility. A man, the male man. The question is, how can a man live up to his personal glory, the fullness of his majesty, the fullness of his stateliness, the fullness of his personal glory, the fullness of his greatness? How can a man do that? The seeds of greatness are there already. I've already said that. They are there. Every man born of a woman has the seeds for his personal glory, the seeds for greatness, the seeds for grandeur, the seeds for majesty, including myself. The question is, why is it that we don't get to that level? Naturally, we're supposed just to gravitate towards that level. Naturally, that is what nature requires of us. The same thing, imagine the sun doing what it's doing at 50%. The world will never be the same. Imagine the waters and the minerals developing, just doing it haphazardly, maybe not in their stateliness. Imagine that. The universe, the environment, it has its personal glory. I mean, it has its individual glory until a man shows up and a man starts messing up the wetlands, creating buildings in wetlands where it's supposed to be created in uplands, you know, cutting down forests and so on and so forth. And the man himself also has issues because he never lives up to his greatness at the end of the day. So what can a man do? That's what we're answering in these episodes. What can a man do? What can a male man do? The one who is called a father, the one who is called a husband, the one who is called daddy, the one who is called grandpa, the one who is called bro, the one who is called uncle. Huh? What can that man do so that he can live to the stateliness of what he was meant to live? Experience the stateliness of his glory, his grandeur. What can he do? There are several things, and today I'm going to discuss one thing. This is not religion, but the first thing that I do believe is going to create a man of grandiose, a man of greatness, it is the knowledge of the divine, the man who is God-fearing, the man who understands that there is something higher than himself. That brings a level of humility. It also brings a level of accountability. The biggest problems you have with men is accountability and humility. In fact, if you wanted to bring down a man in one way or another, go after his ego. If you wanted to create a man who is dysfunctional, go after the man's ego. And the ego, for the most part, comes because we think that we are enough and we are complete in and of ourselves, and we don't need to be accountable to anyone, but everyone has to be accountable to us. So we've got to be God-fearing. I do believe that one of the things that we need to do as men, so that we can ascend to the level of our greatness, the level of our grandiose majesty, the level of our personal glory, it is to be God-fearing. And there's nothing in man as beautiful as a God-fearing man. I can I can tell you that you will argue until the cows come back home, but that's a fact that is indisputable. Now, the concept of God-fearing man has been distorted by religion. I am not going to attack religion again, but a God-fearing man is not as gullible as religion paints it. You know, going around being, looking so humble and so docile and so on. No, far from it. There's a book called Wild at Heart, which talks about the wildness, the courageousness, the adventuriness of the male man. You know what I'm saying? He is God-fearing, yes, but he's a conqueror, he's a king. He's adventurous, he's wild at heart. But he's still accountable to God. A God-fearing man is not as gullible as religion paints it. He does not walk around, you know, chanting religious texts and prophesying. You know, he does not spend a large percentage of his day and week in a house of religion. You know, he's not a wimp that is scared of business, scared of innovation, scared of negotiation, scared of making deals, scared of making money, and scared of this world. He is not saying that I am not of this world and so on. He is indeed a God-fearing guy, but he is also a valiant man who will take your head off if you're an enemy of God. I mean, you mess around with his wife, mess around with his kids, it's going to take your head off. Mess around with his papa, it's going to take your head off. One of the examples I can use there is Jesus Christ. Someone tried to tell him not to do his papa's. He called him a devil. He said, "Get behind me, devil." You know, he's wild at heart. He's committed. He's God-fearing and committed to his goal and his passion. He is indeed, like Jesus Christ said, the salt of this earth. He's able to affect society positively in his input, materially, with his wisdom, with his hands. Hands do not work, by the way. He's a man who works. Yes, he's God-fearing. Don't think that the guys who are, you know, wealthy and rich and so on, and they don't work and they're not God-fearing. They are. I mean, the element of God-fearing does not take away the element of work, does not take away the element of wealth, does not take away the element of prosperity. In fact, people are preaching against prosperity gospel. There's nothing wrong about prosperity gospel, only the abuse of it. But I'm going on a tangent here. This guy, the God-fearing guy, he is indeed the salt of this earth. And finally, but not least, this God-fearing guy, he's filled with knowledge. He's not a wimp. He's filled with understanding. He's filled with wisdom. He's filled with insight. He's filled with counsel. He's filled with who he is. The information about who he is, his identity is known. And his identity is not warped, because his identity comes from the one who created him. His identity comes from God. He's not putting things on his chest and things on his coloring his beard and painting his beard and putting some kind of weird clothes because he's having an identity crisis. He is a man of wisdom about who he is. He is secure in God and secure in who he really is. He is secure, first of all, in who he is. He's also secure in why he is who he is and why he is here on the face of the earth. And number three, he is secure about his manhood. He's not trying to tell people I'm trapped in this body and so on and so forth. But he is God-fearing. All these things are coming from the aspect that I am not on my own. I cannot do things on my own. I get my authority from upstairs, so to speak. I get my authority from God. I am accountable to God. And without God in my life, I can do all those things that I want to do. But at the end of the day, I'm half a man. I'm incomplete. It's as useless as anything to do every single thing that we want to do on the face of the earth as men. And then at the end of the day, it's counted as useless. Remember the parable of the guy who said that, "I am so rich, I'm going to tear down my barns and I'm going to build big ones, and then I'm going to make merry and have fun in life." And he was told, "You fool, your life will be required of you today." He never did what he dreamt of doing. So the man who has his personal glory, his majesty, his grandeur aligned is a man who is God-fearing. But God-fearing does not mean wimpy. Does not mean you're a goose. Does not mean you are docile. Does not mean you are just this humble guy who is not wild, who is not adventurous, who is not daring, who is not penetrating environments and creating changes and taking over territories and ruling and governing and having dominion and having authority. That's what the man is. And those things of dominion, authority, he gets it from his maker. So the first thing about the greatness of a man is a man who is God-fearing. A man who is God-fearing will not take advantage of other people. And if he does, he will feel convicted by it. And he will want to all the time get out of that situation. A man who is God-fearing is a man who has set the foundation to live to the greatness of how or what he was designed and desired and intended to be in the first place. Tomorrow we'll look at another facet. Until then, bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to Life Signatures Radio. If you enjoyed today's show, subscribe to Life Signatures Radio on iTunes, Stitcher, or visit our website at lifesignatures.libsyn.com. Life Signatures Radio, fresh, clean, and inspiring.